Hi there. I don't know how long it takes till I go live. It says I'm live, so let's see. I'm just waiting for my other screen to kick in to prove, because it says end broadcast. I don't want to do that yet. Let's see. Everything appears to be working. And I'm streaming to Twitch today too as an experiment. I have a mostly neglected Twitch stream where I used to stream quite a lot of Diablo stuff and a little bit of Sims. But hey, we'll see how that goes. And it's interesting to me because this experiment is multifaceted. I'm definitely testing this for my own fun. I like to see how this technology works, and it's another bit of bookish talk, right? I have my coffee, which I'll be sipping from. This is indeed a coffee talk. And I just really want to experiment with this because for future use, I'll definitely want to interview a few people or have chats or have some other booktubers on, definitely. And me and Wes Dead Air Knight are definitely going to do a live stream in the future. So, looking forward to that. I'm going to double check my volume here. Yeah, sweet. Okay. Well, welcome to Typical Books. Today we're going to talk about horror fiction podcasts about movies and books. Get a little bit of that normal, typical books sound and visuals going on here. The music will die down in about 15 or 20 minutes or so. I've got other beds too because my podcast is being kind of like expanded to include some interviews. I have an interview coming up I'm going to be conducting on Monday, so I'm pretty excited about that for the podcast anyway. And who knows, a lot of this will bleed over to live streams. I'm editing a video right now, so it's not just all live stream stuff these days. I did a video on Con Lavery's book Rave, which is sitting over here. I finished reading that quite a bit ago, so I've got kind of a backlog now of things that I need to do videos for. I've been reading not, it feels like I haven't been reading enough, but I got some really thin books. So before I get into talking about podcasts, a little post-mortem, of course. I just received Stillborn Gallery. This is by Axel Barnes, a Canadian author, so looking forward to getting into that. Hey Thomas, how are you? You are definitely the inspiration for the upcoming Dead Air live stream. It might be months before it happens, but hey man. And you missed it last week. I talked about your comic, but just us cops. I read Scanlines. If anyone thinks that I was picking on Scanlines for the last live stream about content warnings and stuff, it wasn't. It was just the book that I happened to have in my hand, and it had a really girthy, awesome content warning, which is within the book. So part of my postmortem before I start talking about podcasts is that. Aww. Thomas says he'll be watching for sure. Yeah, when me and Wes get on, he's looking forward to it too. I'm in the middle of reading For Rye. You may remember this came in the mail in that amazing packaging, and I did an unboxing about that, and I put some pictures up on my Instagram as well. So yeah, For Rye. So that's what I'm reading right now. And to talk a little more about the content warning thing, which just as a little wrap up from the last live stream, a little post-mortem, if you will, talking about content warnings. That was raging on Twitter, and I'm not going to spotlight any of the opinions back and forth, but I am writing an essay which will appear on an upcoming episode of a podcast, likely in a while. It'll be on my blog or in my newsletter, probably beginning August, just because I want to like mull over all of that. And it's not going to be necessarily a rehashing of what went down on Twitter, or quite famously, what went down with Silver Shamrock Publishing and how that conversation all began. I don't necessarily want to harp on that, but a lot of really good conversation came out of it. So I'd like to parse some of that conversation out of content warnings and horror, right? So it's been on my mind, obviously, because I can't shut up about it. But yeah. That is going to be a topic for later. Maybe not in Typical Books videos because let's keep it about books and books I'm reading, not ranty Twitter stuff, because who wants to talk about that? I've got this more different camera. I've got a couple cameras kicking around and a couple mics and stuff. And I've got, like, I've realized I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of my light stands, 6 of my light stands out right now. And I've got a couple more in the closet. So I've got like this mess in my office right now of experimentation going down. So if this camera doesn't work out, I don't know, maybe I'll just record on my phone like so many people do, right? Everyone records on their phone. I hope that it's not too quiet. Again, the experimentation, it's like I just can't let go of wanting to put music in behind. Like, why? I don't understand. But I have my Yeti mic if anyone's interested, and I'm using a Logitech webcam, the C750, C something. I think they're out of production now, but I had it well before everyone and their dog was buying webcams, so I count myself very lucky for that. But yeah. So, live streaming goodness. It has been fun. The last stream went really well. Thank you, everyone, if anyone's here that was here last time. Yeah, the phones do work really good. That's what Thomas says. Yeah, phones work pretty good. It's true. A lot of other booktubers and horror conversationalists, if you will, are using their phones. They work better than cameras in a lot of ways. And there's some professional photographers that I know that have a group on Facebook, which is Creative Smartphone Photography, if you're interested. I think it's a closed group, but I'm not sure. You could check it out. And they do some really good creative smartphone photography. And it's just because the technology has gotten so good with the lenses and just the amount of megapixels you can pack into a phone camera now. Grody old coffee. I know I have the gain up on this, so you're going to hear every goddamn sip and grumble. My God, I think I've discovered from podcasting this morning that the coffee does not help your throat. So anyone out there, like Coffee Cats and King, awesome channel. I don't know how he does it without coughing and hacking while drinking coffee. I know my coffee has a real high amount of particulate matter because I do use an espresso roast cut in with Tim Hortons hazelnut. If anyone's ever wondering, now you have the tea on my coffee. Yeah. So, yeah, putting to bed the content warning thing. I'm really glad to see Silver Shamrock Publishing back. I really wish people hadn't jumped on their return with some snarky comments and stuff like that. And it sort of still is rumbling underneath the surface. And many people had turned to Brian Keene's opinions on it. So I'll be talking a little bit more about that in an upcoming podcast. But it was interesting to see a lot of the attitudes toward content warnings. And thinking about like some of the stuff that I read and some of the stuff that I just showed, like that cover of Scanlines and Stillborn Gallery, even though I didn't flip through it, I probably will when I review it, because it's starting out with a bang. And Thomas will understand this, where it starts out with a guy that works in the produce department of a grocery store, much like my podcast co-host West. So I was instantly into this. It's full of Canadiana and Canadian mentionings, and it is dark and if not extreme horror fiction. So very stoked on that, but I don't know where all this content warning stuff will fit when it comes to my channel, because I don't really give content warnings. You may remember a couple of my new releases ago, I had mentioned a book that's coming out, and I mentioned that it had content warnings. I didn't read the content warnings because I'm not handing the book to you. That's the way I kind of look at that. But yeah, interesting stuff. I guess that's enough about content warnings. I know I keep going back to it, but the reason I wanted to talk about podcasts today is not only because I'm on a podcast. I've been on a couple of them. Quick history, years ago, I started recording little snippets with Wes to do Dead Air podcast. They were supposed to be destined for the now defunct Rumorg Radio. There's still a Rumorg Radio France, but yeah, Rumorg Radio. And we had recorded these little snippets. And in the meantime, I also had a short-lived, though power-packed, segment on Dead as Hell podcast that was Dead Cells. And I talked about horror anime. And that went south. And then I was also on Kettle Whistle Radio for a little bit. And that was super fun, actually. I really like that show. And it's more of like a radio show variety. A lot of music, very music-heavy. So, yeah. Very cool show. Yeah, Dead Cells was great. Thank you, Thomas. I'm gonna pop that up just for funsies. Dead Cells is great. short-lived, like I said, but I had a lot of really good input from that show, and a lot of listeners, a surprising amount of listeners, and people still go back to it. So I think of revitalizing it all of the time, but right now I want to stay in horror and horror author stuff, right? So that's where that ended, Dead Cells. Although I still watch anime, not quite as much as I did. And I also had that kind of imposter syndrome because I'm not a 20-year-old weeb, and I'm not like, I haven't been to Japan, and I just started having a lot of like imposter syndrome talking about that. But horror, I know. That's one thing I know. So back to horror, I know. Me and Wes are still going strong. We've taken hiatuses before, but we took a really long one thanks to the virus. And we're back with Dead Air Podcast on splatterpictures.net. We talk about horror movies there. A little, sometimes writing stuff creeps in, especially if we cover a movie that was from a book, right? So we often stay in just horror films. That's why I don't talk about horror films on typical books. Although it's tempting. It is very tempting. If you watch Kasia on YouTube, on Booktube as well, she's doing some horror film stuff, and hopefully that'll be on her show soon enough. Aw, thank you so much. I haven't seen you in a bit. The big one says, I am the best, and loves my channel. Thank you. But yeah, so that's why I keep the two things separate, because I've got an outlet for movie talk with Wes. I just finished recording. We were up early pearly. We used to record late at night, and that sucked. We were both really tired, and he wanted to get his weekend on, and I wanted to go to bed and not be so drunk. And then we started recording in the mornings, which really worked. And it seems so counterintuitive to be recording like a podcast in the bright daylight of the morning about horror movies, but hey, that's what we do. And I thought, you know, why not talk about podcasts minutes after recording a podcast? Whew, what a day. But yeah, there we go. Favorite movie, horror movie so far in 2021? I have to say that I really liked In the Tall Grass, which may be a future Dead Air episode. I haven't watched a lot of new horror because I've been catching up, but I have watched some stuff on Shudder, of course, and they have dug out some old ones. So I don't even know if In the Tall Grass is 2020 or 2021. I'm fuzzy on that. Definitely fuzzy on that. But yeah, so doing that show, in the meantime, me and my husband had met, and he also has a podcast, Bind Torture Cast. I was on an episode or two or three of that, and also one of his episodes of his horror gaming podcast, Run, Hide, Kill. So it's like definitely all in the family. I've been doing like podcasty stuff for a long time. Of course, I listen to a shit ton of podcasts too, right? And there's never enough horror literature podcasts. And not only because I could talk about podcasts all day, obviously. Talk about podcasts too damn much. Yeah, Thomas is saying Shudder's been unloading tons of movies. Yeah, even old ones. They've got like the first George Romero movie and stuff. Like, wow. Shudder is a godsend. People slam it from time to time, but I really like it, especially for that. And if you have one or two streaming services hopping around, there's always something to watch. Always something to watch. But yeah, the podcasts, why? I've definitely had podcasts on the mind. I've had a lot of people on the Twitter and in the BookTube sphere and even in other conversations. It seems to be this ramping up conversation about having bookish horror podcasts, and there's not enough of them. I've said it twice now. I'll probably say it a million other times. I've always listened to horror movie podcasts and horror conversation podcasts, and there seems to be so many more movie podcasts. That is what there are. Oh, hi, Priscilla. Ah, Chipmunk Fast. I can imagine how I sound in Chipmunk Fast speed. Actually, I do know that because there's times when I edited our podcast in Chipmunk speed to get through it real fast. That must have been the most adorable intro. So yeah, the horror podcast thing, there's never enough of them that talk about books. Lots that talk about film. And like Faculty of Horror from the girls at Rue Morgue, and I guess she works at TV Ontario. But yeah, Faculty of Horror is a really great one as well. And I used to listen to, of course, my husband's podcast, which I still listen to, and ours. And I used to listen to, Dread Central's show. I used to listen to Fangoria's show. And I got tired of listening to so many other people talking about horror movies when I could just watch them and talk about them on my show, or listen to my husband talk about them on his show. And the style of horror movies that people were watching, a lot of people are digging back into vaults and doing top tens, was just isn't highly listenable for me, right? So it just, I definitely have lost my interest in a horror movie podcast, and there are so many of them. But that said, horror book podcasts, there's not enough. I used to listen to The Horror Show with Brian Keene. A lot of people had recommended it for the longest time, and I would listen and I would unsubscribe and I would resubscribe and I'd unsubscribe. Some of his interviews were really good, but some of the chit chatter and squealing and stuff, I just couldn't handle that personally for me. I know a lot of huge fans and like diehard fans and friends of Mr. Keene's who definitely listened to The Horror Show all the time, but I was like hit or miss. It wasn't till near the end when I understand how and why that show came to an end, and it makes sense, everything ends, but it was getting really good because it was getting very spicy, and Brian Keene doing what Brian Keene does best and thinking rationally about a lot of the problems in horror writing that would come to his plate because people would put them on his plate. So it was getting interesting from that perspective, but probably not as interesting for readers to listen to because it was all like shop talk and sort of airing of laundry. So I liked that though, but there was a time and a place for that particular show. His interviews, though, especially stuff like his final interview with Jack Ketchum, and a lot of his interviews are just gold, and I like to revisit them and listen to them. Listening to him talk to Rath James White, listening to anyone talk to Rath James White, definitely keeps me writing, and I love that. So that was like a golden show. This is Horror Podcast, and I'm going to see if I can't share a little pecky. This is Horror Podcast is one of my favorites of all time, and I discovered this quite some time ago when they'd first started airing. I highly recommend This is Horror if you're a horror author or a reader that really likes to hear about how authors write or the genesis behind some more recent releases, because they get into that. It's a longer form show, so the shows are lengthy, conversation driven, and I like a shorter show. I like just the facts, you know, compressed stuff. But if you have the time to invest, or you find this, like their conversation with Rath James White or David Moody is another really great episode, an older episode, a very old episode, they talked to Joe Hill. You know, if you like that sort of stuff, yeah, it's very valuable. It's an extremely valuable show. And that's Michael David Wilson and Bob Pastorella that host that show, and it has been going for quite some time. I've been a big supporter of This is Horror for a long time. Let's see if I can't switch this picture. I don't even know if I can. Let's see. I don't know if it'll screw up my stream here. Another one that I listen to a lot of is The Wicked Library, and I absolutely adore this show. Oh, look at that. It actually shares. It's not the biggest picture, but hey. Absolutely adore this show, and it's not because my own stories have been on The Wicked Library. I mean, yeah, that's one thing. So The Wicked Library started out by Nelson Piles, and it was a very small show, and he learned as he went, and that show improved. If you go back to the old episodes of The Wicked Library and then listen on through, you can see that show grow, you can see that show improve, and it is just absolutely fascinating to see. And the stories that are in there are gold. I'm not so big on the horror fiction, but I'm very big on The Wicked Library and Victoria's Lift. Dan Foytek joined with Wicked Library at one point, and the show just became so much bigger. Nico Vitese from We Talk of Dreams does the music in that show. There was some Jeanette Andromeda doing the artwork, and it just got very big, and it was just a beautiful thing. I've been on the most recently, I guess, it was the Halloween special. So I've been on a couple Halloween specials for that show. Highly recommended if you like horror fiction. But they also did segments for a short time, I guess about a year, after they would have the story, they would do Talking Wicked. And it was, Talking Scared is a different thing. We'll talk about Talking Scared, but Talking Wicked was the author interview portion of the Wicked Library. And I loved that. And I wish that they would have kept that up or made two separate shows. I would have been completely fine with that because I wanted to hear authors talking about the genesis of their work and talking about what drove them to write, perhaps what their origin is with story, which is always how the This Is Horror podcast starts out, with talking about what brought you to writing. And I loved that, absolutely loved that, because I just do love the Wicked Library. So horror is one thing, writing is yet another, and there are from time to time horror authors on this show, and there's crime writers, fantasy writers, a lot of dark urban fantasy writers, and I guess dark academia YA authors from time to time, and even nonfiction authors on The Writer Files, hosted by Kelton Reed. And if you are a horror nonfiction podcast that you know of from Horror Gardener, hey, how's it going? More Canadians in the house. Nonfiction horror, as in true crime, or nonfiction book telling, because there's some true crime ones that I like, but that's kind of hit or miss. But yeah, Writer Files, I highly recommend it if you like to listen to authors talk about how they write, whether you're a writer or not. I know that can be super duper fascinating. Writer Files, definitely recommend for authors or people who like to know how writing happens, because he talks about some of the tactics that writers use to come up with the stories, the tactics they physically use when their butt is in the seat, some of the things that they do as far as day jobs. If they are a hybrid author that actually has other work and they work on their writing in the mornings or late at night, or full-time authors, like, it's a really cool show. I like his intro music a lot because it's kind of got this post-punk goth sort of thing going on. And then the talk of the authors. It's just a very well-produced podcast as well. So the next podcast is also a YouTube show. And there's a couple hybrids coming up like that. I guess my show is kind of a hybrid too, because I do broadcast it as a podcast. But The Creative Pen with Joanna Penn, it's all writing all the time. And there is about a half hour of pluggery that goes on usually at the beginning of her show. But it sometimes talks about some recent articles that have interested her. And she talks about AI in writing and some new tools and stuff. So if you're a writer, which I know quite a few of us are here, then that is definitely an interesting show, right in part and parcel with the Writer Files. Writer Files doesn't really talk so much about the marketing and the tactics, but Creative Pen definitely does. So we've got the big one, the best book I've ever read. I think about this a lot. And part of me wants to say The Shining by Stephen King. And I'll return to talking about podcasts in a minute, but this caught my eye. The Shining by Stephen King, Pet Sematary also, but those are also formative books. The best book I ever read, that is quite a question. People Live Still in Cashtown Corners sticks out because not only was it so oddly digestible, and I keep adjusting my earbud if you wonder what I'm doing, it was a tour de force, to use cliched terms. That book rocked my world, if you want to use more cliche terms. It's not a white knuckle thrill ride, though, like so many things ought to be. It is just such an exploration. It lulls you with its language. I love that movie. I helped edit some of the script that's in development, so I've got a really close relationship now. But when I first read it, it was just like anybody else. I picked it up off the table at Cheezing at the now defunct Cheezing Press, and it was at their table, and oh my god, I just love that book so much. So yeah, I'd have to say that's the best book I ever read, just because it was just like a perfectly cooked steak. I don't know how to explain it. It was amazing. And another bookish question before I go back talking about podcasts. Have you got your book signed by the author? Not that one, oddly enough. I have to go and see that particular author, Tony Burgess, not Anthony Burgess of Naked Lunch and, oh my God, Clockwork Orange, rather, because he did not do Naked Lunch. Now I'm confused. But yeah, not of a Clockwork Orange fame, but Tony Burgess, Canadian author. Yeah, I should really get that signed. I think about the best signed book that I have up here is Haunted by James Herbert. And that was quite a find because it was only $10 in a used bookstore. I don't know if he just signed so many books that they're not worth lots or if I got a real steal at $10 for a signed copy of Haunted hardcover. But yeah. Oh, good anthologies about vampire hunters and slayers. There is one recently, Slay. I didn't enjoy every story in it, but it had a lot of really great reviews, so I'm not the best judge of that. And I'm reading another one, Vampire Compendium, I forget. Priscilla Bettis has a story in it, and it's upstairs. That is next on my reading list, too, because I read her story and then put the book down. So that is another one. Maybe if Priscilla is still here, she can fill me in on the title of that. I will put it up. Oh, yeah. Thank you, Thomas. The best book I have up here is Pray Lady. That's the hardcover, too. I'm pretty stoked about that. So let's see. I'm going to switch back to another picture of a podcast that I like, which is also a YouTube show. Year of the Author. Now, Year of the Author has K.E. Francis as the host, and I loved it when she does mainly voiceover talking. It's a podcast, really, on YouTube, and it's really fascinating. She has a really great writing tips and stuff, good book reviews. She has a very wide reading taste as well, and she shaved her head not long ago, which I found highly entertaining. I really enjoyed that because it's a brave thing. I often think of shaving the rest of my head because I've got this mohawk under here, and it just made me think of maybe doing that. But yeah, Year of the Author is another YouTube podcast hybrid, so podcasts on YouTube. And I've never really parsed out The Vampire Connoisseur. Okay, I was wrong with The Vampire Compendium. So the big one, the book, The Vampire Connoisseur. Another one is Vampiric Variations by Nancy Kilpatrick. I also recommend that too. But Slay is mostly about hunters that you would really enjoy. Zen and the Art of Vampire Slaying or Hunting is another one that I talked about in the last new release video too. But yeah, Year of the Author is a podcast on YouTube, which isn't something that I've necessarily parsed out, which, okay, I have my YouTube show, which is Typical Books, and I do YouTube, like Dancing Monkey stuff. You can see me and hear me all at the same time. There's music in the background and pictures. It's a YouTube show. It's a fairly typical YouTube show, with Booktube show number one. And then one day my friend Thomas had said, hey, I would love it if Typical Books was a podcast. Have you ever thought of making it a podcast too? And a week later basically I was like, here is a podcast. And I just put it up as a podcast as well. So it's a hybrid show, but YouTube first. And some of them, like Year of the Author, for the most part, is podcast first. Same with Creative Pen with Joanna Penn. It is podcast first, YouTube second, because a lot of them are no video, right? So is that still a podcast? Is it still a podcast on Typical Books? There's another one, Hoag Law, that does a video game show, and it is a podcast on YouTube as well, but there's video to go with that, right? So the other one is Dead Headspace, and I hope the image flips over here. This time delay always kind of mixes me up a little bit. Dead Headspace, this is podcast first, not a YouTube show that I know of, although it'd be really cool to see them on there. Dead Headspace, if you like horror fiction, they talk very heavily about that. And one that I forgot here is Books in the Freezer. So I'll talk about Books in the Freezer in a second. But Dead Headspace is newish. It's out from book, no, it's not the Book Riot show. It is out from Silver Shamrock, I believe. Even though it's not the owners of Silver Shamrock that host it. The host is Patrick McDonough, and there's a co-host as well, but they interview authors, and it is a fantastic show, really. The audio quality isn't 100%, but it's a newer show, so we'll give it time. I'm on board, entirely on board with that one. Really good as far as horror, nonfiction, talking about the different tropes and talking about the things that authors go through to bring us these stories, right? So highly fascinating to me. And what have we got here? The Horrific Podcast is a darling show. There are not enough listeners of the Horrific Podcast, and it is one of those shows that is YouTube first, right? There's music in the background and some scenery as well. And I've had snippets of my work read on this show, and there's one coming up. So very excited to hear that, actually. But it is a newer show with not as many listeners or having long form conversations about the craft of writing and self-publishing and what it takes to publish. But first and foremost, it is horror fiction being read. So really fantastic show that way, as far as a mix between nonfiction and fiction. A new-ish show that has taken the world by storm is Talking Scared. Talking Scared, actually, I was turned on to it when I was reading Whisper Down the Lane, and they had Clay McLeod Chapman on the show. And it was after I had read it, I'm like, oh, I want to hear about what the story, like why it was born. And it was a fantastic interview. So if you like hearing about the genesis of stories and hearing some really big name horror authors talk about their craft and their stories and what scares them and where these stories come from, Talking Scared podcast is like fantastic, actually, for that. I highly enjoy this new show, definitely new to me show. And I don't think I have a picture because I only threw these up really quickly for Books in the Freezer. And booktubers may be very familiar with Rachel and Ganyo. What's her first name? Oh, hi, Kelness? Not sure how to pronounce your name, but hi to the Netherlands. That's awesome. Thank you very much. Hello. But yes, Books in the Freezer is a fantastic show that is also made by two booktubers. And I really enjoyed that when Rachel was on it as well. That's when I was introduced to the show, and Rachel had reviewed some of my books on her BookTube show. And so I became very, very interested in that podcast. And they have a theme. And that's another thing that I really like about that particular show, is that it's not just, here's an author, let's talk to the author, same old questions. Not that a lot of these have the same old questions. I've picked some pretty of my like favorite podcasts for that reason, right? But they have a theme, and let's talk to you about dark academia. Let's talk to you about isolation. Let's talk to you about winter horror. And they choose their authors specifically for that. Stephanie Gagnon, that's her name. I actually remembered it all by myself. Okay. Super Cozy, K. Canis. That's a beautiful name, and Super Cozy is exactly what I want on a Saturday afternoon. Oh, God. Thank you so much for clearing your pronunciation up. I'm pretty big on that, being a journalist. I try to never be shy to ask people how to pronounce things properly. So thank you. Yeah. Books in the Freezer, highly recommended. I wish I had a picture to show everybody just so it would stick in the mind and the craw and the soul, the way that Books in the Freezer has stuck with me. There was a time that I had unsubscribed, and it was an audio quality thing entirely, and I would like dip in depending on the topic and if I weren't listening in headphones, because that's why I'm so picky with audio quality, is because I'm often listening in headphones, and I'm also very sensitive to like loud and screechy noises or bad audio volume leveling. And I may have been one of those people that had a show like that in the past. Probably my next podcast will be leveled poorly. I don't know. I am not immune to that problem, but just I can't physically take it, right? So I have definitely become a subscriber all over again to Books in the Freezer. And I really enjoy when they have different co-hosts on too. So that's another way to like mix it up, in my opinion, is not only talking about horror and different topics and tropes in horror and how to write horror and talking to authors about where their horror comes from, and then talking about specific themes, having other people on who are on other podcasts or authors who have, like Grady Hendrix, who have a really a great ability to deep dive into some of the things that we may have, some questions that we may have as readers about these books. So I think that listening to many different podcasts, whether it be craft podcasts like This Is Horror or Books in the Freezer, where it's an appreciation podcast first and foremost, I really enjoy that because I don't listen to a lot of the fiction podcasts. If you can recommend any really good fiction podcasts, preferably short horror fiction, just definitely let me know. Well, thank you, Thomas. Yeah, do you all, as far as you and Chris and Wes and your the horror movie podcast family, it is a family that way, do audiobook readings? Your voices are great for it. No, and yes and no. I've read some excerpts of other people's works on the show when something like a Stephen King book or the original Psycho plays into the story. I've done a couple readings. I've done one on YouTube. I've done one on my SoundCloud account, which is available on my website under Free Fiction. I think it's still there, of Crocodile Rot. And that was even, you know, I wasn't even that good at recording myself at that point. I've thought of doing readings. They never go over really well. It's fun to do. I like doing them. So I don't know if other people are interested in hearing them. One thing that I do really like is when Harpies in the Trees, Merce at Harpies in the Trees, does readings, because she has a really good voice for it too. And I think that if I threw a blanket over my head and my microphone too at the same time, right, to get the good sound, I could do a pretty good job. And with some post-production, throw some sounds in there, it can be a lot of fun. Horror Gardener. I love hearing authors read their own work. It helps me get a sense of pacing for their stories. Nightworms has a great series of those. Yes, they do. They definitely do. And I've been loving a lot of this, you know, because we're all homestuck. Everyone's been live streaming stuff and seeing Mother Horror do anything. When Sadie's on anything, I definitely tune in. I missed Brian Keene's talk on Friday, so I'm going to try and go back and hopefully it's up and it wasn't just a live stream deal. But yeah, hearing authors read their work, Nancy Kilpatrick does a fantastic job. I like hearing, even though it's nonfiction, Malcolm Gladwell. I like hearing him read his own stuff, and I hear it in that voice, right? So yeah, I would really enjoy hearing more contemporary authors read their work. I would like to hear more splatterpunk authors read their work, and that's where we dip back into a content warning conversation, because a lot of that is just not for public consumption necessarily. So it would be tough to put it on some sort of like Twitch or YouTube thing. And I have to definitely say again to Thomas, thank you for showing up. You're the Twitch viewer. So I was experimenting on both streams and I'm very stoked that this is actually working. So you're proof it's working. But yeah, I do love hearing authors read their work, which is different to me than a horror fiction podcast. When an author reads their own work, you do get the right inflection and the right tone and the real sense of the atmosphere that they were striving for. And there's nothing lost in the interpretation. Some authors aren't good readers, sure. I mean, a lot of authors are too nervous to read their books, and it is a particular, peculiar skill. I mean, whether you go to like Toastmasters or watch other people do it and learn how to do it and listen to Chuck Palahniuk read his stuff and things like that and get good at reading your own work, there's some authors that just aren't. Like Stephen King, a great guy and all, fantastic, he is the king, but he's not that good at reading his stuff, unfortunately. Hot take. That's me spilling tea. That's my unpopular opinion, if you will. But yeah, some authors are really good at it, some authors aren't. I don't know. I guess I'd have to say I'm middling. I like live readings a lot. The KGB reading series is something in New York I've always wanted to check out, and they have a YouTube show now because they can't do it, right? So they're doing it on YouTube, and they had discovered that even though they can only pack like maybe 50 people into this bar, they used to do the readings in the KGB bar in New York, they can get so many people online that why return to the live venue? And if you do return to the live venue, can you wire it for sound and video? Because it's just such a treat to see some of the fantastic authors that they get on there. So yeah, there's something about an author reading their own work that is super special. There's a note here. Oh, hi, Rob. I've done reading a few chapters of my book, but only do it every so often when doing live videos, etc. Otherwise, I don't bother because I'm pretty crap at it. I'm just going to pop that out because it's a lot of text. But yeah, I feel like I am too sometimes. I've got better by recording myself. And I think it also helps that sometimes I will write longhand in fiction and then record it. Well, not record it, but like speak into a microphone for text or speech to text to capture it, because I'm even worse at typing. Horror Gardener heard Guts Live by Chuck Palahniuk and almost passed out. Like, I can believe that entirely. I mean, I've heard the rumors that that is an upsetting thing. And reading that section, even on my own, and having my own imagination filling in those blanks, with an author reading it, there's particular things that they hinge on. The way that the commas and pauses, semicolons, if they use them, the way that sentence fragments hit, because Chuck Palahniuk's really great with sentence fragments, it would be, yeah, it would get to you more than it ought to, I think. I had read a section of one of my more grotesque stories, Crocodile Rot, live at Black Squirrel Books when they were a newish bookstore and they were hosting some readings. And there was a few people that they didn't quite get faint, but they were very taken up with it. And when the grotesquerie hit, it was a real gut punch for them. Also, just to see a fairly soft-spoken person read this horrific stuff in such a straight voice and trying to put a little theatricality into it, even though I was no drama kid. I could have learned a lot, though, by reading some drama textbooks, definitely. But yeah, the horror author reading. Sometimes in the Wicked Library, they have authors read their own work, but for the most part, it's performed. And I love having my work performed by other people. I have had two of my books. Yeah, two of them, three of them, two of them as audiobooks too. So hearing Michael D. Pope talk, like do my books, perform my books is always like a kind of magical thing. There's always though those little things like how to pronounce particular names or words, or there's a book where someone speaks like my grandmother used to speak. Unless you know my grandmother, you don't know how my grandmother used to speak. So that character is always going to sound different to me, because everyone is going to interpret her differently. But yeah, as the author, I can interpret it that one way. So how long have we been on here? I was going to say like an hour or so. I'm not even sure. I was looking for a little clock. I'm going to be wrapping it up soon. So if anyone has any input on podcasts or authors reading their own work, I'm probably going to be doing a reading on the podcast because it just doesn't go over as well on YouTube. But I would do it if people are interested. Thomas asked, do you have a book club? No. And I thought about it. Chapter Stacks had a very active book club. And, 44 minutes. So we're getting close to what I had envisioned. Okay. Thank you, Priscilla. The book club thing. I think about it, and I think of buddy reads more often. I had a very fun buddy read with some of the girls from the Creepy Cocktail Hour, which is Merce and Murray McWilliams and Alex from the Bookubus and Regina at Regina's Haunted Library and myself, and we read a Richard Layman book together, and it was fun. It was super fun. But Yeah, I think that's just another facet of being online, right? I have had my head stuck firmly into a monitor since 1994, and I try and take screen breaks. This counts as a screen break. There's a screen, there's several screens around me, but I'm not really looking at them. So it's like a screen break. I always look for a screen break. And that would be, I would like a physical book club, like a few girls, guys here in town get together, have a book club. That would be so rad. I don't drink, and a lot of those book clubs are very like box wine books, right? And that there, if you want a podcast idea, box wine and books. There's been a lot of talk about podcasts coming up. Let me take that down. Yeah, it is impossible to get away from a screen nowadays. And I've had an online book club, whether it be on Goodreads or on a Discord or something like that. I would just be, it's another place for my face to be that isn't out in the real world, right? But yeah, I know that Nikki and Jason White, when I first discovered Jason White was long before his Booktube channel was on a podcast. So there's been some rumblings on Twitter about, I want to start a podcast. Let's start a podcast again. Oh, who was it? That Brad Proctor just began a more bona fide show, like it's a live show, and I believe it's being broadcast as a podcast. So there's a lot more of that happening. So be on the lookout for a lot more of us BookTubers to end up on podcasts, because it has been rumbling not to supplant or displace or replace our bookish BookTube shows at all, but to fill a perceived gap. Even though I talked quite a bit about shows that talk to authors, and specifically shows that talk to horror authors about writing horror, there is a vacuum. And a lot of us BookTubers are writers or really want to talk about and think about and have conversations about why this horror is showing up between pages, and have that longer form conversation, maybe to have it frozen in time as well. So be on the lookout for more bookish horror podcasts, not just typical books, because that's going to grow a little bit, but I think there's more coming around the bend. So thank you very much for showing up, and I hope you enjoyed the live Undead Typical Books today. I'm going to do another one probably in 2 weeks. We'll see how it goes, and another topic is what I'll need, that's for sure. And I'm going to toy with the idea now that I think, once I watch the broadcast over again, that this is looking pretty good. I hope it's sounding pretty good. I'd like to have some authors on eventually as well. Not on a very, not very often, but I would definitely like to do it. So, yeah. Thanks again, and have an ooky, spooky day.